Hello students, we shall be discussing about various aspects of vision and its assessment in this video. Various attributes to vision are visual acuity, visual field, color vision, contrast sensitivity, and dark adaptation. Regarding visual acuity and field of vision, we have already discussed in previous videos. In this video, we shall be discussing about color vision, contrast sensitivity, and dark adaptation. And apart from this, we shall also be discussing about the assessment of vision in preverbal children. Color vision. Young-Hemel's theory of color vision suggests that color sense is the ability to distinguish between colors as excited by light of different wavelengths. It is a function of cone and therefore occurs only in photopic vision. Physiologically as well as anatomically, cones are of three types. All colors as well as white light can be formed by these three colors in suitable proportions. Hence, normal color vision is called trichromatic. There are three types of cones, small, medium, and long, and they are named as beta, gamma, and rho. And they can sense different wavelengths as suggested in this range, like beta can sense a range between 400 to 500 nanometers with peak wavelength from 420 to 440 nanometers and so on. The opponent process theory. This theory assumes that three sets of receptor systems exist: red, green, blue, yellow, and black and white. Each system is assumed to function as an antagonistic pair. Stimulation of one of the opponent pair not only produces excitation of that receptor system, but also produces inhibition of the opponent receptor system. For example, in red-green system, if you stimulate the red cones, the green will get inhibited and vice versa. Similarly, in blue-yellow system, if you stimulate blue, yellow will get inhibited and vice versa. Similarly, it occurs in black and white also. The options present on L and M cone are encoded on X chromosome. Regarding color vision abnormalities, most individuals, even with color deficiency, can distinguish a great many colors, but interpret them differently. That is, they can see most of the colors, but the interpretation of their color is different from other people. Most common type of deficiency is anomalous trichromacy, in which the affected individuals have three cone pigments, but one of them is abnormal. That is, they have all the types of cones, but one of them is abnormal. Protonomals have abnormal red sensitive cones and require excess red to match the yellow standard, while deuteronomals have abnormal green sensitive cones and require excess green. And this is the most common anomaly. Tritonomals, in this, the blue sensitive cones are abnormal and extremely rare condition. Dichromatism. They have two cone pigments. That is, in place of three cone pigments, they have only two cone pigments. and thus cannot distinguish certain colors. And the most common form is red-green deficiency. Here the term used is anopia, that is, in protanopia, there is lack of red sensitive cone, and in deuteranopia, there is lack of green sensitive cones. And tritonaps have trouble in distinguishing blue from yellow. Another form of color defect is monochromatism or achromatopsia. They have only a single cone pigment or who lack cone pigments altogether. Color vision can be tested by the lantern test. In this test, only a simple requirement is there, that is a system which can project different colored lights. And the tests do not specifically screen for color defects, although it is expected that color defective observer will not perform as well as the observers with normal color vision. Home grain wools are used as we do in daily routine work while matching different colors of wools and clothes and threads. In this test, in which the subject matches various colored skeins of wools. The most commonly used test for color vision in our OPD is use of isochromatic charts. They all provide efficient screening of congenital red-green defects. Basically, these tests consist of a series of cards on which colored dots of discs of various size are printed to form a multicolored figure against a multicolored background. Here, most of you can see written 74 on a multicolored reddish background, and here on greenish background you can see a path of oranges or reddish path. Ishihara pseudochromatic charts are most commonly used in our OPDs. Another method of testing color vision is the Franzwerth-Munsell 100 hue test. In this arrangement test, the observer is required to arrange color samples by similarity in a sequential color series. Colors are mounted in caps, which are numbered on the back. The test is more time consuming as it has 85 tiles or pastels to match, but it is acknowledged to be a sensitive indicator of aptitude for hue discrimination. The other variant of this is D15 panel, which has less number of pastels. Both the panel D15 and the 100 hue test differentiate among protons, deuterons, and triton defect by axis along which confusions are made. This is the basic picture which is used for Franzwerth-Munsell 100 hue test. Anomaloscope. Anomaloscopes are optical instruments in which the observer must manipulate stimulus controlled knobs to match two colored fields in color and brightness. One is presented and other he has to match. The anomaloscope is the standard instrument for the diagnosis of color vision defects. When supplemented by information from other color vision tests, the result provided by this instrument permits the accurate classification of all color deficiencies. Dark adaptation. Above a certain level of luminance, about 0.03 candles per square meter, the cones are more active. and responsible for photopic vision. As a person enters a dark environment, the rod activity progressively replaces that of cones. So a person can see better in black and white due to rod activity in dark environment, providing scotopic vision. In mesopic light, both the photoreceptor and cones work together. Evaluation of dark adaptation is particularly useful in investigation of nyctalopia. The retina is exposed to intense light for a time sufficient to bleach at least 25% of the rhodopsin in the retina. And following this, normal rods are insensitive to light and cones respond only to a very bright light. And subsequent recovery of light sensitivity can be monitored by placing the subject in dark and periodically presenting spots of light of varying intensity in visual field and asking the subject if they are perceived. And the threshold at which the subject just perceives a light is recorded. And this is shown in this graph. And the flash is repeated at a regular interval. And the increased sensitivity of the eye to light is plotted. And this is sensitivity curve. Here you can see that in the beginning, the rods are not sensitive to the light, while cones are sensitive to the light. As the time passes away in the dark room where the subject is made to sit, the sensitivity of the cone increases because he becomes sensitive to decreasing illumination of the light. So that the sensitivity is increasing. At around 5 to 7 minutes, you can see that the person cannot see the colored objects because the cone sensitivity has reached to its maximum and now it cannot see much more dimmer light. But at the same time, the sensitivity of the rods has started increasing. So the person can perceive the object in black and white because the sensitivity of the rods are increasing. And it continues to increase up to the 30 minutes. And the patient is becoming more and more sensitive to dim light. Contrast sensitivity. In clinical practice, visual ability is tested by means of Snellen's chart, we all know. But a patient may complain of visual disturbance who have acuities of 6 by 6 or better, and you will think that the patient is normal, but still he will complain that his vision is not normal. But the patients cannot describe precisely what the change in sensation is like. That is what they are having. They will simply say that their vision is not good as compared to the other eye. They may describe this vision as misty or flat. This is due to contrast sensitivity. Black over white or white over black, as in Snellen's chart, is 100% contrast. However, the ability to perceive slight changes in luminance between regions which are not separated by definite border is of equal importance. This is responsible for quality of vision. In daily life, objects are seen in different shades of light. It is not always full bright or dark, as we see leaves of tree beyond the background of the whole tree and blades of grass on a field. So it is not always full bright or dark, but it is in different shades. Here, this is a typical contrast sensitivity chart in which you can see the letters written, that the lines are in decreasing contrast. If anybody can read from this line to the last line, it means that his contrast sensitivity is good. But in certain optic neuritis or in optic nerve diseases, this contrast sensitivity decreases. So the person can read the whole line, that is, his vision is 6x6, but he will not be able to read the full chart. So the patient will describe that his vision is, you will see that his vision is 6x6, but he will say that his vision is not good only because of this decreased contrast sensitivity. Low spatial frequency contrast sensitivity and high spatial frequency contrast sensitivity charts are used to detect various other diseases of optic nerve, and these are also a types of contrast sensitivity and used clinically in various optic nerve diseases. Evaluation of vision in preverbal children can be challenging because they cannot read ordinary test types and they are uncooperative also. So for them, either visual evoke potential or preferential looking test is used. VEP is used in children below 2 years of the age, and older children can manage with both preferential looking test as well as visual evoke potential. Preferential looking test, that is PLT. Before that, the first evidence of vision in an infant is seen at around 1 month of age, when the child gives social smile to his mother. Other clue is straight eyes. If the child is looking at you with straight eyes, it means that his vision is normal in both the eyes. And any squinting of eyes may indicate less vision in squinting eye, and cause of which must be determined, and full evaluation must be done. Preferential looking test or PLT of acuity using the Taylor acuity card or similar other are based upon the principle that a child would rather look at a picture, or pattern rather than a homogeneous field. And the smallest pattern that child can seem to prefer is an indicator of best visual acuity. Here you can see that pattern and homogeneous field is shown to the child, and the child will look at this pattern, and this can be recorded by video camera or something else. Similarly with Taylor card also, here that child is looking at the pattern, and with decreasing size in the pattern or the decreasing size of the picture, if the child can still see that, it means that his visual acuity is good. And when he starts losing interest in pattern or picture, it means that he is not seeing that object, that is, he is perceiving this as homogeneous field. And these are the time consuming and difficult test, but very useful in evaluation of visual acuity in a child. Optokinetic nystagmus can also be used to measure visual acuity. Optokinetic means one object moves in one direction and then that vanishes, and then again the same pattern comes and it moves again in this direction. While you can see that while rotating this bar will move in this direction, and it will go behind, and then a new, this will be replaced by a new bar, and the eye will keep moving like pendulum, slow and then again fast, slow and fast. If a, this is a very attractive test, and if the patient's eye can move along with this optokinetic stimulus, it means that he is seeing this. And if he loses this its interest, it means that he may not be seeing that. Visual evoked potential, that is VEP, test records electrical activity of the visual cortex created by retinal stimulation. The VEP is used mainly to test optic nerve function. It can also be used for objective assessment of visual acuity in children and uncooperative patients, that is a patient, when a person is unconscious. The technique is very simple. The stimulus is either flash of light or flash, that flash of light, when it is flash of light, then it is called flash VEP. In this, a goggle is fitted over the eye and a flash of bulb is put on and off at frequent interval, or a black and white checkerboard pattern as in chess on a screen, and this is called pattern VEP, or periodic reversal of this pattern also stimulates and results in pattern reversal visual evoked potential. And with decreasing size of this pattern, can be a visual acuity can give a measure, or the evaluation of EEG, that is VEP. EEG is nothing but VEP is nothing but EEG with retinal stimulation, and this gives a fairly good function of optic nerve as well as retina. Here you can see that either flash is on or flash is off in flashlight, flash method. But in pattern method, a pattern is presented over the eye, and this may be reversed with time, and this gives a better result than this flash method. And this EEG is recorded here after giving the stimulus. When the light is shown over the retina, or the pattern is changed over the retina, and the time taken in this spike, that is this in getting this spike, means that this has the time of the travel of the stimulus from retina to the cortex is this much, and we call it latency. And this is the amplitude from trough to peak. This amplitude gives the stimulation of the cortex, amount of the stimulation of the cortex. And this is the time to travel from retina to the cortex. This is called latency, and this is called amplitude. Interpretation of visual evoked potential. Latency and amplitudes are assessed. The timing of the onset of response is more reliable and generally more useful parameter than the amplitude. Amplitude is generally recorded as positive, that is P100, that is positive 100, or negative, that is N75 and N135. Pattern reversal VEP is a fovea specific response, as it depends on form sense and may give a rough estimate of visual acuity. Flash VEP is a crude test and merely indicate that light has been perceived. So for testing visual acuity in a slightly older child, Pattern reversal VEP is more specific for visual acuity. In optic neuropathy, latency is increased. Latency means onset of response after stimulation of the retina by light. And amplitude is decreased. In optic neuropathy, latency is increased and amplitude is decreased. With this, I say thank you to all for patience hearing.